it or not, you're actually at the second of our wellness series here at the Aspen Chapel. We had a pastoral committee was looking after how to look after people when they were ill, and we thought it would be a much better idea to keep people well. So we would devise a series that included, we had some hiking, that was part of it, and various other bits and bobs. And we thought a series of talks on wellness would be a good thing to have. And our first one was done by Connie Fisher over there, who did one on stress. And we're delighted that both Connie and Andrew can be with us here this evening. Now, Connie and Andrew are both, I'm told, original thinkers and writers, filmmakers, and workshop leaders. And they met originally in upstate New York in October 2003, out of which they wrote their famous book, The Trust Frequency, which you'll find over there. Connie, I don't know if you know, is a Mayflower descendant, and she's from the Baxters of Maine, and she has a worldview that includes Native American elders, and she creates forums and visions for people. Andrew is a writer of both fiction and non-fiction, born in England, like me, and brought up in South Africa, and came here in 1969. And settled in Santa Cruz with a number of leaders of the Emergent Consciousness Movement. They both founded the Inn Institute in Sedona, which is an 8-acre retreat, and now they run the famous, you'll see it outside, I've seen here, Trust Mobile, which travels around, enabling them to travel, write, take photographs, films, and spreading an optimistic vision of the future and spending as much time as possible with their grandchildren. Not tonight, though. They're with us, and we're delighted that you're with us tonight. I'm going to take a couple of photographs, it's all right with you, just for their website, but I'll hand over the evening to you. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you, Nicholas. And we are filming this, but we're only filming ourselves, which is really useful for us to document our process.
It gives us and maybe put it on YouTube if we say something feedback. Brilliant.
And I have to say that the first of these wellness events was Connie.
Yeah.
And the second of these ones is Connie. What's going on?
Yeah. The third one is not Connie, it's the Hope Center, I'm afraid. So we've ruined our...
Don, I thought there was a pattern.
No, there's no Connie.
Well, we're thrilled to be here, Nicholas.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for having us. So, we feel that emotional, spiritual, mental and physical wellness comes from our core assumptions about the nature of the universe, which is our worldview or our paradigm. Our book is called 10 Assumptions for a New Paradigm. So we're big picture thinkers. So tonight we're going to take you there and give you some tools for perhaps shifting one's worldview into a worldview that's now becoming known through quantum science, that in fact the old science that drove our worldview is obsolete. Okay, we're in a time of change. And so the good news is that this new worldview and this worldview that we've pieced together, okay, this isn't the quantum science worldview. It's not an indigenous cosmology worldview. It's a synthesis that we've created, and it's a construct of definitions of use of certain words in certain ways and new assumptions about the nature of the universe. So it's a synthesis of the wisdom of the mystics, of the Eastern and Western mystics, and the indigenous people, and modern science, and common sense. So we'll take you on a little journey through that, because we have an hour and a half. This is a big deal. We're doing a workshop on Saturday that'll give a little more in-depth, but we'll do what we can not to overwhelm you with these assumptions, because it's very hard to take in this kind of information when one has a construct that one has inherited from one's families and cultures, and one believes it to be true, just so foundationally that we don't even question it. So, we believe that the lack of wellness comes from separation, that assumption of separation from?
From almost everything. We humans, with our brilliant intellects and our left brains, have managed to separate ourselves from almost everything. You made a list of the things we think we're separate from, starting with the universe, starting with God, continuing with each other. Look, how many separate bodies are there in this room? It's very compelling. It's very difficult to remember this thing that we might call oneness or unity consciousness. But if whoever of you are tracking what's going on out there in the sort of the mainstream spiritual world emerging from India and other places, this whole idea of unity consciousness or of oneness. Have you heard of the Oneness University and a process called Diksha? So, you know, this is relatively new. It's ancient wisdom, but there's a new focus on the sense of unity, which is desperately needed at this point because we humans have separated ourselves, even within ourselves. How many of us in this room have a higher self and a lower self? Most of us think that's kind of a New Age concept. Oh, that was my lower self sort of second-guessing my higher self. That's another split. We are split and split and split. So a part of the work we do addresses the split in the human psyche, the split. And historically, if you go back to Newton and Descartes and on through to Darwin, you can see a major bifurcation or a fork in the road of humanity. Prior to that, sort of religion was pretty much the dominant. We were told what to think. Rome, the church, told us what to think. If we were in India, whatever culture you were part of, you were pretty much given a religious cosmology. And then the scientific paradigm kicked in. And Connie just said that old worldview is obsolete. It's not necessarily obsolete. Newtonian, Descartesian, Newtonian science still works perfectly. If you want to send a rocket ship to Pluto, you need that. It works. However, roughly 100 years ago, everybody knows this, Einstein comes out with a total game changer. And here we are, a century down the road, and we're just beginning to get what it might mean to us as humans, to society, to the planet. And it's very timely, because the two things that we gain from quantum physics, for example, are one, the observer effect. We create what we put our attention on, firstly. And secondly, quantum entanglement, the fact that we are all interconnected, that everything influences everything else. There is only one. And that is now proved through mathematics, through science. This is very interesting. This is ancient Vedic wisdom. This is ancient Australian Aborigine wisdom. This the indigenous people have known forever. And we Westerners sort of split ourselves and separated. So what we're talking about tonight, and as a result we've become unwell. We're seeing so many signs of unwellness, from physical unwellness that might result in cancers and various illnesses, to the social unwellnesses that we might see in ISIS and various bizarre manifestations of human activity. What do we do about this? How do we heal ourselves? Is it possible to do that? Well, if we're operating, I love that word, you know what an operating system is. Most of us, anyone in this room, not have a computer, right, with an operating system. Does that operating system ever need an upgrade? Yeah. What's the operating system of the human being, of our mind? What does it run on? It runs on beliefs. It runs on assumptions. It runs on opinions, it turns out, that are changeable, because if you go to the operating system of humans pre-Newton, it's quite different. If you go to the operating system 100 years ago, it's quite different from what's emerging right now. So our operating systems are way overdue for an upgrade. So to get specific about our operating system, it is a set of assumptions of beliefs that we've inherited from our predecessors, going back multiple generations, very often fear-based, anxiety-based, scarcity-based, the neighbors are dangerous, I'm not worthy, the universe, well, with Newton, of course, the universe ceased to be God. Before that, there was nothing but God. Love was all there is. God is love. Love is all there is. Suddenly, science says, no, 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 there's no such thing. We can't measure it. It doesn't exist. And all of these beliefs go deep into our psyches and create the worldview through the lens through which we view reality. So these are thoughts. Where did they come from? They were created by humans. Are we humans? Think so. Can we?
Almost.
Are we evolving humans moving towards something? I like that idea. Point being, these are ideas that were developed by humans to face whatever the situation was at the time they faced them. If you were afraid of saber-toothed tigers attacking you in your cave, you had a certain strategy that you passed on to your kids. Is that appropriate in Aspen, Colorado right now? To walk down the street looking over your shoulder in fear of something that isn't real. So our point is that it is possible to exist, and these things are unconscious. What's an assumption? It's a belief that we take to be true without examination. Right? An assumption is an unexamined belief. It is something that's in there. It's an axiom. It's axiomatic. It's taken for granted. Can we change that? Yes, but we have to do something. We actually have to bring these unconscious assumptions to consciousness. We have to become aware of them. This ain't easy. It's not come to a workshop, listen to these guys jabbering away, read our book, and, oh, got that onto the next New Age book on the shelf at Explorer. It's work. It's actual, real work to dig into our psyches, and it's challenging. Okay, so what we are going to do tonight is to present you with a sort of a really quick sort of manifesto or summary of what we see as a possible solution, a way to move from the unwellness that we feel in our bodies and feel in our societies and feel as a species into a state, a higher state of wellness. Because my understanding of physical sickness, for example, is that a very high percentage of it is caused by psychosomatic thinking, factors, energy. Our thinking determines the way we manifest in life, including our own personal health, our wellness, how we function in the world, psychological wellness, emotional wellness, spiritual wellness, just plain happiness. We subtitled our book, The High Road to Happiness. And, you know, when you write a book, you pretty much are required to then put into practice the stuff that you wrote, right? It's great to have this wonderful theory. Put it into effect. And I have to say that I like it. It's working for me. And I think it's working for this young lady.
Oh, yeah. And yesterday we spoke at a spiritual center down in Carbondale, and a woman who had our book, she said, I've read your book through and through, and I carry it in my car, and whenever anything comes up I need, I know I can just open it and come to something that'll take me to that higher place. She said, and life is so easy. Okay, stress goes away. Anxiety goes away. We know we are loved by a conscious, loving universe, and we just can let go and trust and act according to our inner promptings. And know that it's all good, and it's all going to be okay. So what we'd like to do is just take you there a little bit. I'm going to read sort of a synopsis of this construct. And then we're going to go through our definitions and assumptions. We're going to have each of you read a definition, and we'll talk about it a little bit, and an assumption, and hopefully be able to do all that in the required time. You could keep us posted on time. That would be good. So, the trust frequency. We live in the now, in a conscious universe, driven by unconditional love. The seven A's of our consciousness, awareness, assumption, attitude, attention, alignment, action, and allowing, carry specific vibratory frequencies which have their own distinct laws. They are our requests to the universe, which loves us so much and so unconditionally, it gives us everything we ask for. The universe wants more for us than we can imagine. Free will enables us to choose our frequency and thus the reality we experience. The abundant, joyful nature of the universe is available to anyone, anywhere, anytime who chooses the trust frequency. And then here's a little sentence with the seven A's. With expanded awareness and accurate assumptions, we choose our attitude and consciously direct our attention, align with our highest inner promptings, with committed action, allowing the universe to manifest beyond our wildest dreams. Does that sound like heaven? Well, it's our job to bring heaven to earth. That's what this whole evolution of humanity is about. Bringing heaven to earth through our own choices and our behaviors. And we're just giving tools for how to do that. Because once we understand, it's the logical mind operating on misinformation at this time that's gotten us where we are. All the systems we've built that we think are the only game in town, well, they're not. They're the game we've created in this frequency. There's another frequency. And Jesus lived there. Sermon on the Mount, you go to the Sermon on the Mount, he said it very plainly and clearly. Worry not for what you will wear and eat. Look at the lilies in the field, they toil not. Right? And we're all drove up about what we're going to eat, what we're going to do, what job we're going to have. Worry not. It takes you into a higher frequency where your soul's destiny awaits and the magic happens. But unfortunately, that A of action, we do have to live it. We have to walk it. So, we're going to give some tools for that. And the other, I mean, you'll see this, you know, I referred to Jesus. You know, we're in Aspen Chapel. Jesus is a favorite around here, I do believe. And John Lennon, the song Imagine. Star Wars. You know, Star Wars isn't a religion in some countries. You know, just go to Yoda. He's got it. Obi-Wan Kenobi. The whole gang, you know. It's there. It's in our face. But we call it fantasy. We say, I can't do that. I have to be in the real world. Well, it depends what world you want to be real for you. It's all a matter of individual choice. We can live in another frequency regardless of what anyone else is doing around us. Except they'll think we're stark raving mad. Just ask people who've been here for 30 years. Is Connie Baxter Marlow stark raving mad? Or what? Okay? I let my son drop out of first grade because I knew he was loved by a conscious, loving universe. And he would be given everything he needs to become the gift he promised to bring. So, anyway, Patricia, there's been a few people around who remember me rattling a lot of cages here in the 90s. So, we will... Do you have anything you want to add?
Sure.
Okay, and then
what? I'm good at adding stuff.
And we'll take them to the...
Connie may have mystified you somewhat at this point by her reference to something she called the seven A's. Was that mysterious? What on earth does that mean, the seven A's? And then she proceeded to read something that happened to contain seven words, each beginning with the letter A, starting with awareness and ending with allowing, right? So this was our quest in the book to give, to sort of deliver something useful, usable, in terms of consciousness, that the consciousness that each of us comes with, that which we experience, the first time we open our eyes and breathe our first gasp of air as a child, that is consciousness exploding into being, and there was consciousness prior to that, and prior to that, and prior to that. And now we emerge from this beautiful place in the womb where we can truly trust because we're within and we're fed and we're nurtured and taken care of into this rather tough world where we have lessons to learn and perhaps missions to remember from wherever we came from before that. And what the toolkit we're given is this thing called consciousness. What is that? We attended you remember the film, What the Bleep Do We Know? Right? There was a conference in Santa Monica right when that film was peaking, and it had five or seven of those folks who were in the film. They were up on the stage, and someone in the audience on the last day said, excuse me, to the group of scientists up on the stage, excuse me, could you define consciousness? And guess what? They could not. They actually had, they sort of, each of them had a little nibble at it, but there was no sort of coherent understanding that came back to the questioner as to what consciousness was. Science has had enormous difficulty with the subject of consciousness. You really can't measure it. The current theory is that the complexity of organisms allows for consciousness to emerge and that it's an epiphenomenon, a phenomenon that arrives as a result of the complexity of a creature. So a human being is capable of more consciousness than a tree or a jellyfish. It's actually the other way around. Consciousness pre-exists, predates everything. But the point is that it seemed, and even psychology and philosophy have had enormous difficulty defining or saying something truly intelligent about consciousness. Go to the dictionary. What does it say? One word, awareness. True. If you're not aware, you're not conscious. So, and perhaps human consciousness is self-aware, self-awareness, self-reflective awareness, right? But there's much, much more. What do we experience? We experience every day, the moment we wake up out of our dreams, and in our dreams, that's another form of consciousness, we're experiencing consciousness. So we started to write down words like awareness. Okay, let's start with awareness. Fine. Suddenly, wait, there's way more than that. How about assumption? Do assumptions condition or is our consciousness somehow channeled through assumptions? Attention. Quantum science tells us where we put our attention, the observer effect, is what we perceive, is what our reality is. If I am constantly putting my attention, just to be very current, on the latest bad news in the New York Times every day, that's the reality I'm creating for myself. If I'm putting my attention on our gorgeous little grandchild, our little five-year-old who lives in this magical realm, I'm going to be in a different reality, and on and on. Action. What this turns out to be is more like it's pretty much a toolkit. It's a toolbox of concepts that we actually can check in on our own state of mind. And the final one is allowing. letting go, just trusting the universe, trusting God, however you want to see that, trusting that it is. You know, the Africans say, ashe, ashe, those who say, so be it. Trusting that you can let go, knowing that all is well. And if we can trust with that degree of trust, right? If we can really elevate our vibratory state to the point where we're just in literally what the Buddhists would call nirvana, right? The Buddhist's practice is designed to take you. You don't have to die to go to the heaven of nirvana. You don't have to die to go to the heaven we're talking about in the trust frequency. It's a higher vibration. It's what Bob Marley's talking about when he's singing his uplifting reggae songs.
And you left out attitude and alignment, but that's okay.
I had to leave some for you.
That's fine. And then there's also Nike who says, just do it, right? You remember that?
And this button that says, just trust. Please just help yourself to a button when we're done.
And so we'd like to just take you through this construct, if you'd like to journey through that a bit. And we'd love for people, if people are willing to read our definitions, you know, one person read one, we'll have a little discussion, and then move on through it.
So there's a handout on your chair or under your seat or wherever it ended up. And it starts out with, we use language in an uncommon way sometimes. And so we had to actually start out with some terminology to define some terms so you know what we're talking about when we talk about humanity, when we're talking about love. What do we mean? Are we talking about what is commonly accepted? Are we using commonly accepted meanings for our words? And the answer is, in a number of cases, not. So that's the need for this, so that actually then the rest of it, the bottom part, the 10 assumptions, actually make sense. And what the 10 assumptions are, they're an offering. They're us offering our best shot at replacing current assumptions. When was the last time anyone in this room had somebody walk up to them on the street and say, excuse me, what are your 10 most fundamental beliefs? It's not something we are trained to do in this culture, are we? It may be that if you were born a Tibetan Buddhist and you were headed for monkhood, that kind of thing might be in your schooling, but it's not in ours, is it? So, and yet, it seems to have real value. So these are 10 alternative assumptions. We're not saying they're it, but we are saying that if you were to choose these and take them on, it works, because it's simply a higher reality. Each of these assumptions, if you think of the current assumption, for example, the first assumption is that we live in a conscious, loving universe, which is very different from the description of the universe that I was raised in as a scientist. You know, I was a physics and mathematics and chemistry major. And the universe that I thought I understood from that was nothing remotely like this. Just think about that, how different one's existence is if I know profoundly that I am an inextricable part of a conscious, loving universe that supports me, holds me, that where I can totally let go of fear. Versus the wonderful mechanical clockwork device that the awfully high percentage humanity has been told is the truth, and it doesn't even know we exist. To say it loves us is absurd, right? How could a clockwork mechanism, a machine, love us? So the machine metaphor has really taken us into much of the trouble that we've got ourselves into. So,
okay, so who wants to read the first definition?
I'll do it.
All right.
Assumption, a core belief which we take to be true without question.
So that, you'll find that in the dictionary. That's a very normal, most people know an assumption is simply a core belief which we take to be true without question. And I will repeat these because I think it's important to just nail these things. Okay.
Okay, the next one. We're going to move right along so we can...
Paradigm, a set of agreed upon assumptions which create a consensus reality.
Now think of those two together, okay? An assumption is a core belief, singular, which we take to be true without question, right? It goes in there, we don't have to look at it. It's been in there so long, we don't even know it's there. If you take an entire construct, an entire paradigm or entire worldview built of these core beliefs which we take to be true without question, so a paradigm is a set of agreed upon assumptions which create a consensus reality. This world that we has many consensus realities. This is one of them right here in this room. Here is a consensus reality that we have agreed. We're all basically dressed in related manners. I don't see anybody in a loincloth. You know, if we were doing this in the Amazon jungle, we might not be dressed like this or sitting on this kind of folding chair. So these are consensus realities which we humans have developed out of a set of common assumptions. Consensus reality.
So
what we're saying is that can be changed.
Okay. That can be changed.
Yes. Next.
That's the good news.
Next definition.
Next.
Humanity. Okay. A collection of divine, autonomous, sovereign beings who have chosen to incarnate on earth to learn and grow on their soul's journey to wholeness, each with an individual purpose and a unique gift.
So this is key. This is very fundamental and contains several assumptions, really, and very important ones that are key to our construct, and that is that we are divine, autonomous, sovereign beings who have chosen to incarnate on earth with a gift and a purpose on our soul's journey to wholeness. This is our overarching act of free will in this construct. Okay? This is very important. It's our overarching act of free will. We agreed to come here and incarnate into a family that we chose. So this could be a stretch for some, but we're just taking this construct, okay? For our soul's journey, so that we could come into wholeness, which is our recognition of our divine, autonomous, sovereign nature, that we are one with all things, that we are divine, magnificent beings who came to bring a gift to the party, which is us. Okay, this is key, foundational stuff that changes everything. Not that we're this little speck that nobody knows anything about and who wants me around, I'm just little old me. Well, guess what? Little old me promised to bring something to the party. Your heart, your spirit, your gift, whatever that is. Not what society's expecting. To please daddy, to please society, to show up and tell the teacher what the teacher wants and not end up in the principal's office. All that stuff worked at putting us in a little box of what society expects of us, which is a key to our lack of wellness. Okay, if you don't take anything else home, that definition and knowing and coming to understand that and coming and breaking through those masks and those behaviors and those things we've taken on, goals, all those things we take as givens, let it go. See what the universe wants for you so you can bring your gift to the party. It doesn't matter if you're a janitor, that's a good thing. Be a whistling janitor that brightens everybody's life whose place you're cleaning for. If you're the neuroscientist who's going to change the world through the whatever it is. It wants you, all of you. And that's the mandate on the planet right now, to go deep inside, cleanse those things, those self-doubts and self-hatreds that are bringing lack of wellness to us. Our body's screaming at us, hey, you're out of balance. You're it's time. Go inside. Clean it out. Come to the party. Bring your gift to the party. So that's key to this wellness conversation. So do you want to add anything to that?
No, I think that was great.
Okay. So the next one is key. Yes.
And love, the fundamental unifying and creative force.
How about that? Love, the fundamental unifying and creative force of the universe. Think of that in terms of quantum physics. What would quantum physics make of a statement like that? There's a subatomic particle called the gluon. Have anybody heard of the gluon? G-L-U-O-N. Mm-hmm. It is derived from the word glue. It is that which holds everything together. So I had this... We go to a lot of conferences. There's a beautiful conference called Science and Non-Duality that we love. And one of the scientists there is just someone we admire tremendously. His name's Dean Radin. If you haven't heard of him, he's
worth Institute of Noetic Sciences.
He's the chief scientist at the Institute of Noetic Sciences, which is the organization that studies consciousness, that does this work from a hard science standpoint. And I nailed him one day and I said... Excuse me, Dean. This particle, the gluon, and this concept that we're presenting, love with a capital L, could they by any chance be the same thing? And we'd had a conversation prior to that, so he knew what I meant when I used the word L with a capital, the word love with a capital L. He said, I think so. That's pretty significant. He is also a quantum physicist who wrote a book with the title The Conscious Universe. And there are five books at this point with the title The Conscious Universe and several with the title The Living Universe. So,
the idea of a conscious,
loving universe is not that outrageous in terms of science. I mean, I'm talking about science books using titles like The Conscious Universe. I asked him and another one of the scientists, I said, so it's a conscious universe, does that mean it's alive? And they like looked at me like I was nuts and said, of course it's alive. Ooh, that changes everything. To know that the universe itself is a living, evolving being. Wow.
Which some people call God.
Yeah.
Anyway, we'll go on. The next one, we got to keep moving here.
How are we doing time-wise?
Would you mind repeating his name, the author?
Dean Radin,
R-A-D-I-N.
Institute of Noetic Science.
R-A-D-I-N. Dean, D-E-A-N.
Okay.
R-A-D-I-N.
They do work on paranormal stuff, scientifically proving that the paranormal exists. He's written a few books. He has a new book out. So the next one.
Frequency, the vibratory rate that determines the characteristics of a particular reality. There is a wide range of frequencies, each with its own reality and its own distinct laws.
Okay, so...
I'm going to repeat that. Frequency, the vibratory rate that determines the characteristics of a particular reality. There is a wide range of frequencies, each with its own reality and its own distinct laws. Try finding that in the dictionary.
Okay, so we're talking about the trust frequency. Okay, so what, and when we're talking about the seven A's, okay, they're not only our requests to this loving universe, they actually determine our frequency, where we're vibrating at, okay? So that takes it out of hit or miss or I don't care, doesn't matter, you know, it takes it into hardcore, okay. Where do I want to be vibrating? You know, so there's two ways of looking at it. Your request to this loving universe, where you put your attention, and you put your attention on that stuff that's in the news right now, it takes your vibratory level down. So that is your reality. You see how it's a request, but it's also a determinant. Okay, and people, when we talk about this, and people say, well, I don't believe that, so, and I, blah, blah, I'm like, that's fine. We all have the free will to create our own reality. We can have the nastiest reality we choose. That's how loved we are by the conscious, loving universe. So it's not about judgment. It's about what frequency we're vibrating at, what our reality is. The earth is moving into a higher frequency. So we have the choice if we want to go with her or if we want to stay at this lower frequency, because nobody's going to be able to be here on this earth. I don't know if the earth's going to split into two so the people can go, you know, I don't know how many of you read this stuff, but, you know, something's going to happen where the people that want to stay in fear can do that. They want to stay at the lower vibration and doing this stuff. But earth is moving into a higher vibration. We have the opportunity to go into a higher place with all our friends who choose to do it. But we have to let the people who don't choose to go their way too. It's all personal choice. It's all it is.
Can I have a question? Is that also linked with energy in people? Like if people are very low, negative energy.
Sure.
That sometimes when I lift, you know, try to lift those people up. But it's impossible.
Yeah, let them go. You have to let them go.
That can be hard.
It's a soul level choice. It's a conscious choice. And I'll tell you, I've lost so many people in my life, and it's really sad. But they just don't want to be around me. They can't be around me. And you shift people when you're in their presence. You actually shift them into a higher frequency for a minute, maybe. And then, I mean, I've watched it happen. They go and they see things. And then they drop back down. So it's work and it's choice. Just that simple. Nobody's going to judge you. It's not about God judging anybody. It's choice. What do we choose? And it just doesn't matter. It doesn't matter to me what you choose. I'm not here to change what you choose. I'm here to give you information.
Seems like it's also about knowledge as well. I think the overwhelming majority of people don't know that they have a choice.
Exactly. That's what we're doing is putting on the table. That's what we're about.
Right.
Putting it on the table.
There are a lot of people, I think, here who have done some work with Michael Brown's work about changing, and you move through the different frequencies to, you know, to go from mental, physical to mental to emotional to a vibrational stage where you are calm.
Yeah. And we just have another take on it, you know, an articulation, what we've seen and what we've experienced, and a way of seeing it and understanding it.
Right. So it seems similar.
Yeah.
It's related.
Totally. Yeah. So let's keep moving because we're going to run out of time here. But I'm glad
On the subject of time, the time is, if I'm not mistaken, 6:48. And are we going till 7:30?
We are.
Yeah. I think we have tons of time.
Okay, good. Well, I'm glad you're contributing.
Just on the subject of time, I just want to... I thank you all. We're like out of towners and it's enjoyable, but we have to leave at 7, so I apologize if
that's
okay. Disrupt you.
Thank you for telling us.
Yeah, at least we know you're not just like these guys and nuts, I'm leaving.
So I'm glad you're contributing, because I was going to leave time for Q&A, but let's just kind of
We will.
Do it as it comes, but let's keep it short so we can at least get you as far as we can through this.
All right. So
did you want to say anything about else about frequency?
Well, look, let's go to the next.
Okay.
The next one is,
who would like to read
Michael,
that?
Would you like to do that one? Oh, you just did.
You just did, sorry.
Where am I?
The trust frequency.
Where's the soul destiny awaits with more abundance, balance, and freedom, and joy than we can fathom? Where the truth nature of universe is experienced.
I'm going to read that out again. The trust frequency, where the soul's destiny awaits with more abundance, balance, freedom, and joy than we can fathom. It is where the true nature of the universe is experienced. So that point, when we're in the trust frequency, we experience life in a very different way. It's a completely, it's an altered state. It's another way of being.
There's no traffic.
Yeah.
In the trust frequency.
Yesterday, actually, who was it who went to the yoga class? Right. And would you mind just reminding us what your...
Yeah, the yoga teacher yesterday had a, she always has a theme, and she spoke about how, you know, our mind can always give us worst case scenarios. We tend to go there, and she knew she was going to be late for class, and I'm not going to find a parking spot, and my students are going to be upset, and she's pulling into Carbondale, and a car pulls out within a block of the studio with a bumper sticker on the back that says, "What if everything turns out okay?"
There is a beautiful, beautiful example of the trust frequency in action from yesterday's gathering down in Carbondale. Yeah.
So, the next one?
Free will. Mm.
I can read it.
Okay.
Free will. The right to choose one's frequency.
The right to choose one's frequency. How about that? How about our consciousness, our vibratory state, is actually sort of like a slider, those ones, wonderful things we have on the computers, or if you're an audio engineering guy, you actually have a dial you can turn up, right? Our frequency can be anywhere we choose. This is what free will in its highest manifestation is about. We can choose to vibrate wherever we like. As Connie said earlier, we can choose to be utterly miserable. I know people who are not happy unless they're miserable. You know, they get their kicks out of just, you know, these sort of negative predictions and what have you. Did you know, by the way, that today is the end of the world? Yeah, so that was a big one. Of X wave is hitting us, and here we are. We're gone. We're actually sitting in heaven, folks. You know, you're going to have to email your friends back in Aspen.
But one thing I came to understand, that free will is the right to not align with your highest inner promise. Isn't that interesting?
The freedom to make that choice.
The freedom
as well.
To make
we
that
are
choice.
In fact completely and totally free. Somehow we were created, and somebody opened the door and set us chickens free, and here we are. You know?
And I liken it to the. I don't know if you know about the, in the Greek myths, there's the labyrinth, and who is it?
Ariadne
in the labyrinth, pardon? And so it's our choice. If we listen to our higher selves and act accordingly, it's like following the gossamer thread through the labyrinth. We don't even know there's a labyrinth there, okay? But if we don't, and if we don't, we hit the wall. Oh, darn it. I guess it's not that way. I'll turn this way. Go that way. Hit that wall. And hit that wall. We'll get through it. We keep hitting the walls, right? We'll get through. Maybe not in this lifetime, but the next lifetime. So it's our choice. We've just got our internal guidance system. Andrew uses it all the time. His internal GPS. He's way more intuitive than I. And he gets us around without. So that's the same concept. Just listening and acting, trusting. It's just that simple.
Connie mentioned earlier that there's no traffic in the trust frequency. And if we have time at the end, I'll tell a couple of stories around that.
Okay, what's the next one?
Circumstance. The seemingly uncontrollable outward events that influence our decisions.
Circumstance. Again, you won't find, if you go to the dictionary and look up the word circumstance, it won't say this. Circumstance. The seemingly uncontrollable outward events that influence our decisions. Now look at the previous one, free will and circumstance. This is almost like predestination. You know, do we have the freedom of choice, or is it all set in stone already and there's nothing we can do about it? Well, it's a paradox. Two sides of the story. And I think if you're detecting a pattern emerging, the Connie pattern fell down after two Connies. But these 10 assumptions actually, we had no idea at the time, arranged themselves into pairs of paradoxes. Something, here's one, and then the second one contradicts it. They raise contradiction. These are so outrageously counter to what we have been trained to believe. But each one raises a paradox, and the subsequent one resolves that paradox.
We say we resolve, we present and resolve six of the major paradoxes that have plagued humanity for millennia with these 10 assumptions and definitions.
Thank you.
So, circumstance loves us more than we do. Circumstance guides us on our journey to wholeness. Circumstance is the conscious loving universe that we said, yes, you may take me on my journey to wholeness. Okay? So, circumstance, the divine operates through circumstance, things we never do or choose that serve us. The worse it is, the more divine you know it is, the more bizarre and horrible and like, how could that have happened? You know, it's the divine working for you. Okay? So this is a big flip from the victim consciousness to the beloved, to know, which we spoke about yesterday at the spiritual center. We know we are loved by a conscious loving universe. And everything that happens in our life happens for us, not to us. So, let's move on to the next one.
Okay. So, next one is consciousness. Anybody?
I can read it.
Thank you.
Okay.
Consciousness. Universal consciousness. The primordial life energy of the universe. Human consciousness. The active and passive phenomena of awareness, assumption, attitude, attention, alignment, action, and allowing, which determine our frequency.
So I'll read that again. So really there are two kinds of consciousness in the big, big, big picture. The universe is consciousness. There is nothing but consciousness. There is that conscious entity that you can call divinity, God, whatever term you like to use for it, you can call it the universe. And it is consciousness. It consists of consciousness, entirely of consciousness. And everything that is manifest is a manifestation of that consciousness. Everything that appears to be solid is actually consciousness in some sort of agreement to, you know, that camera there, the molecules and atoms are holding it together. But it is simply consciousness. So, universal consciousness is the primordial. It existed before and will continue to exist forever. The primordial life energy of the universe is consciousness. But we are each issued with what we can regard as human consciousness. I spoke about this a little while ago. And just once again, the active, note that certain of these are active and certain are passive. Awareness, assumption, attitude, attention, alignment, action and allowing, and each of these determine our frequency. So it's part of what we're bringing that I think is completely unique, I've never heard of this anywhere else, is ultimately it's Connie's idea that these different frequencies exist, that these different phenomena, our awareness is on a sliding scale of frequency, our assumptions, our attitudes. Can you see how all of these tie together and those seven things add up to facets of how we perceive reality, how we perceive the world?
Okay, the next one.
The universe, all that is, both manifest and unmanifest, also known as God, Creator, Atman, and so on. So we call it the conscious loving universe.
So here's the biggie. The universe. All that is, capitalized, both manifest and unmanifest. There may be countless multiverses. It may be an ever-unfolding phenomenon that we, from our limited perspective, can really know nothing about. Science is very interested in these things and struggles with these ideas. We live in an extraordinary time where we are making discoveries about the nature of the physical universe in ways that are just extraordinary, that were unthinkable 100 years ago.
So,
all that is, both manifest and unmanifest, also known as God, it's the same concept, creator. The Native Americans talk about creator or the great mystery. Atman, Atman's a Hindu term. Atman and Brahman, and there's a whole ancient Hindu, East Indian, Vedic philosophical construct that's extremely profound and is being sort of proven or at least supported by contemporary science and so on. We simply call it because many of these terms have come with baggage. The religions have become so divided among themselves, so divisive of us. You know, just think of the Christian churches. How many are there? Now suddenly we have Pope Francis, who seems almost to be a unity person, right? Although I'm not seeing him stepping outside of the Catholic Church. I mean, that would be very difficult for him to do in his position. But boy, Christianity has divided us into all these sects. How many are there? There's thousands and thousands of them. It's extraordinary. It's wild. And then the divisions between Islam, because we have a different name for the conscious loving universe. We use that term because it doesn't seem to have that baggage, and I trust it will never become a religion where people are going to start fighting and arguing about it.
And one thing, the manifest and unmanifest, we've manifested in this frequency with our thinking scarcity. Our economic system is based on the concept of scarcity. Okay, we are living now in a time where there's not enough for how huge a percentage of the population. Our environmental whole crisis and belief is on the concept of scarcity, that there's not enough clean water, there's not enough oil, there's not enough. But when we think of the unmanifest, what percentage of the universe is dark matter, is unmanifest, and what we create, what we put our attention on, and what's outside of our attention. And so we bring in Jesus again with the loaves and the fishes. Okay? He fed the multitudes on these few loaves and fishes and had 40 bushel baskets left over. Okay, he reached up into the unmanifest and brought it forth. It is way more abundant. It's unlimited abundance. And that's almost heretical in these times of the environmental situation. That's, as I said, based on scarcity. It's not enough. And we're taking too much. Okay? But in this higher frequency, there's more abundance than we can fathom. And I know people who actually can do what he did here, now. Native Americans who've done it and who've told me, you know, yeah, we just keep ladling it out. It just keeps coming out of the soup thing. And someone else told me that they fed a whole troop of Girl Scouts on one package of hot dogs and one package of buns and had leftovers. You know, I mean, this is not the only game in town. I promise you. We don't have a clue, ultimately, because this constantly, our brains are only thinking in terms of the laws in this frequency. We get into understanding there's a higher frequency where the laws are expanded. Okay, Henry David Thoreau said in his conclusion to Walden.
This gentleman right there, you can't really see.
This here. Okay. Old Henry. We present at the Thoreau Society all the time. He was a cosmic thinker, mystic, as was Einstein and a lot of other important people. But meanwhile, he said in his conclusion to Walden, when one walks confidently in the direction of his dreams, he will pass a certain boundary. He will experience a success unexpected in common hours. The laws that apply to him will be expanded, or new laws will be made in his favor, and he will live with the license of a higher order of being. That was the cincher with this trust frequency stuff, because I see this frequency, I know it's there. And this was the kicker, the real, okay, the laws are different in the different frequencies. Wow. It's really cool. So
I'm just going to make sure the camera's still running because I can't see the darn.
What we want to do now, because we're going to start running out of time, I'd like to take you through the first two assumptions because we've really hit a lot of the other ones. And the first two are game changers that we're bringing to the table. I mean, we've got a couple other game changers, but these first two are key to this, to the whole construct. And then the other ones are pretty basic. So, who would like to read the first assumption? Yes.
We live in a conscious...
Thank you.
Okay.
We live in a conscious, loving universe. There is only love.
Okay, and who would like to read number two?
So we live in a conscious, loving universe. There is only love. The universe, in fact, consists entirely of love. You remember the definition that we had, which was not holding hands?
Let's deal with it.
Patricia?
Okay, number two.
The universe loves us unconditionally. It gives us everything we ask for.
The universe loves us unconditionally. It gives us everything we ask for. And I suspect that last part is challenging for a lot of us. The universe sometimes seems to give us things we did not ask for consciously. And it doesn't seem to give us things we do ask for.
We gave you those requests. Okay, we went into the seven A's and, you understand now what our requests actually are.
But this is a part of the challenge. All we can do this evening is to give you just a little teaser of this. And we actually have a workshop coming up on Saturday where we'll have a little more time to go deeper into this. But the fact is it takes more than that. What I'd love to do is spend 5 days, Monday through Friday, dealing with just one assumption in the morning, another assumption in the afternoon, do that all week, and by the following weekend, if we can really get that into our beings, not to just agree with it intellectually or say, well, that sounds cool, or I've always thought that, but really to find a way to live it, to put it into our operating system so we're truly doing an upgrade that will take effect and last.
And what in order to do that, one has to take this stuff as absolutely true. We're not saying it is absolutely true. That's called dogma. We're saying take it on as absolutely true, as an experiment. See how it changes what you think. The answers we get depend on the questions we ask. So when I look at the world and what's happening in the world, I say, okay, how is this serving the coming of peace on earth and heaven on earth? Because for me, that's all there is. It's all there ever has been. There's nothing that happens in our personal lives or in the world. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. There can't be anything else. That's all there is. For me. So when I ask that question, I get an extraordinary different answer. Radically different answer. So this concept of assumption number one, we live in a conscious, loving universe, there is only love. Okay, if you take that as absolutely true, God is love. God is everything, right? All that is. We don't do God specifically, but we know that God is love. Okay, and I don't know how many of you here feel and know and understand, or is your belief that all that God is, all that is, everything is. So, if you take A plus B, which are core assumptions, God is love, God is everything, then what? Everything is love. All those things we perceive as not love, I'm sure you're running through lots of things that have happened to you, lots of things that have happened in the world, all the atrocities, everything, right? You're like, what are you talking about? But if you take A plus B, you have to come to C. It is love, every bit of it. We don't know a person's soul's journey. We don't know what they came to experience, why they incarnated into that family who abused them, who abandoned them, who killed them. Okay? We don't know. We know our soul's journey. Do we even know our soul's journey? Okay? What's going to happen to us when we walk out that door? We don't know. But we know, if you take this construct, we know that whatever it is for us, not to us. Whatever it is. So that's a game changer. Because we were at a conference recently, Consciousness of Immortality conference in Sedona. Very high folks on the consciousness field. And I said to them, they were all sitting up there, and we had spoken there, so we were kind of on the inside, so I got to get the microphone. And I said, okay, now this is going to shock you guys. I said, I have a friend who was just brutally murdered in Aspen, Colorado. You know who I'm talking about. If you guys just said, there's only love, only the soul's journey, they were talking this stuff. I said, then that has to mean that that was a loving act. And they could not go there. But from my perspective, if she came to Earth to be murdered, someone had to do it. Okay? Someone had to show up to do it. Look at the circumstances. It's pretty bizarre. The more bizarre it is, the more you know it is love. So, just wanted to take you there because without that peace, the absolute nature of being able to see the conscious, loving universe, absolutely, you can't go there. You're still victim perpetrator model, still in that frequency, victim perpetrator. Oh, poor pitiful me. Poor Nancy. Poor, I know her daughter's name. She's my son's best friend. I just lost it for a minute.
Juliana.
You know? But Juliana's going to go to places she never would have gone before. As a human, as truly Juliana. And everybody of her friends, all of us, we're going to go places. Every loss takes us someplace we wouldn't choose to go, in deeper into our hearts, breaks our heart open. Unless we go into victim perpetrator, and anger, and revenge, and all those other old ways of responding. So,
I'd like to say something on that subject, because Connie I just felt that. You know, she said this is going to shock us, and it did, and it does.
And I'm sorry if I...
And I had only met Nancy a few times and didn't know her. But the conference that we presented at, which was titled The Consciousness of Immortality down in Sedona, the two headliners of that were two people who have had powerful near-death experiences. One of them was Evan Alexander, who wrote the book, the bestseller, Proof of Heaven. The other was Anita Murjani, who wrote another bestseller called Dying to Be Me. These are two folks who have been to the other side and come back to report on it and brought us it's a very scientific, I mean, Alexander is a neuroscientist. He was a cynical neuroscientist who did not believe that this kind of thing was possible. And he was taken into 6 days of coma and came out of that drink like, whoa. Point being that no matter what appears to be happening on the surface, these terrible things we read about happening in the Middle East, this experience that Connie just spoke about, if there is indeed no death, if there is indeed merely some sort of veil between that reality and this reality, if that state of heaven is just, it's right here, right now, in this room, tuned to a different frequency.
And that's a quote from Evan Allison.
That's actually in Evan's book. It is right here, right now, and but it is tuned to a different frequency. It's not some other place or some other time. Those are human constructs in this 3D reality, time and space, in the eternal space beyond that. So the fact is, you know, with my recently lost my mom, she was 94, it was time to go, and when she died in Johannesburg, South Africa, one of the great blessings is she was no longer there, she was here. She's right here, right now, tuned to a different frequency. But mom is a part of me, right here, right now. So the terrible sadness we feel for the loss of a loved one, for a friend, Connie's dad right now is 95 and he's getting there. He's on the edge. He will leave fairly soon, we think. His body, he's in perfect shape, except his body's breaking down on him. This is the most fabulously comforting information that I personally have received in a long time. And we had just finished writing and putting out the Trust Frequency book when Proof of Heaven was written. And when I read that book, it broke me down. I wanted to rush into the other room and tell Connie, but I couldn't talk. It took me about 30 minutes to get my mouth to actually work. I just had to sort of lie there in a strangely paralytic state. I was so blown away by certain moments in that book that just hit me that hard. It doesn't happen very often. So point being that in the Trust Frequency, it's literally heaven on earth. And the great message we brought, actually we did a our presentation there was, this was all about the near-death experience. And our presentation had to do with the simple fact that we don't have to die to get to heaven. We don't even have to have a near-death experience to get to heaven, because a near-death experience is pretty traumatic for all concerned, is it not? A death experience is very traumatic for all concerned, especially if it's an accident or violence or something. There's another way, there's a third way to get to heaven. It's not to get there, it's to get here. There is no there, there's only here. And so this work, once it's really working, once it's functioning, once we're vibrating at this higher state, we're in an altered state that, that all the spiritual seekers throughout history, everyone who ever took LSD or you name it, or had an epiphany, here it is, folks.
And the people who've gone there to the other side actually come back and confirm our most outlandish stuff we're saying yeah. in this book. Okay, we have stuff in this book that we didn't even understand, but I knew Spirit wanted it in there. Okay, and we're just getting it now. And so they confirmed this most outlandish stuff that it actually... And this is the other point I wanted to make. So they confirm it. It exists there. And when I asked that question of these people, and they couldn't go there with this everything is love concept, actually articulated, they can say it. Everybody's been saying it forever. What I realized was, recently, that it's a habit. We have a habit. That habit is thinking that love is kindness. Okay? That's just a habit. They couldn't break through it when I asked them. It's just a habit. It's we're locked in that concept. And as long as we stay there, there's not love. There's still that duality. Okay? What we're talking about is a place that's beyond duality, beyond right and wrong. Okay? So as long as we keep that habit, we're just going to stay in duality. We get beyond that habit. We understand that we are so loved, so unconditionally loved, that we are going to be given. We believe in scarcity, we're going to have scarcity. That's love.
Does that make any sense? The reason it's love is, and the reason the universe is giving us what we ask for is because if our mindset is such that we believe in something, there's another way of looking at it. We create reality through the power of our consciousness. It's one of these assumptions here. We recognize that we create reality, that the universe is simply responding to what it is within ourselves. We are actually creating that. The love of the universe, I even have a hard time with that, because we actually are the universe. We are completely connected. It's not a universe that's somewhere over there separate from me, giving me something because it loves me. It is me. I am it. So I am part of the universe exercising my co-creative piece of the puzzle.
Well, this is how I learned to understand it. I'm listening to Bibles and it is God is love. And then God created us as his image. And now as the people talk about the flesh, and say, I don't think that's the image of God. What came to me is, if God is love, and he created us as his image, that we are love.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
See, that was how I understood.
How could it be anything else?
So she just went through deductive reasoning.
Now, folks, we have exactly 10 minutes left. And what I would like to do is to very quickly read the other 8 assumptions, if that's all right, just so we get through them, just so we complete this. And to bring us back around to the purpose of this evening, which has to do with wellness, and I would just preface this by saying that if we can get ourselves into this higher state, we are by definition happier, we are by definition healthier, our wellness quotient or meter has gone through the roof. We are in a different place, even if we are dealing with something like cancer, for example. There's a woman, I think she was in upstate New York somewhere back in the 80s. She wrote a book called Thank God I Have Cancer. That was the title of her book. She was so blown away by this inner change that occurred because she was diagnosed. Every breath became precious to her. Every friendship became precious to her. Every bird, every leaf, and she's transformed her life. It didn't matter that she had cancer because she had this epiphany type experience.
Okay. So
this is really important. Connie said just the first two, but hang on. We create reality.
You're just going to read them all?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. If that's okay. Well, that's a quick way of getting through this. We create reality by the power of our consciousness. As an assumption, remember what an assumption we're offering you, 10 assumptions. An assumption is a core belief which we take to be true without question. We take this to be true absolutely. We accept this. Okay? We create reality by the power of our consciousness. The fourth one is not necessary. We've been through this a number of times, and I'll say it again. It's to do with, obviously, consciousness. We simply call it the 7 A's now. Awareness, assumption, attitude, attention, alignment, action, and allowing determine our frequency and are our requests to the universe. 5, free will is an absolute law of the universe. We have the freedom to choose our frequency. We are masters of our own destiny. 6, circumstance guides us on our journey to wholeness. 7, there is only now, this precious present moment. Living trustingly in the now, we experience the true nature of the universe. The next one, 8, is critical to the wellness factor that we are talking about. All of creation is one. Separation is a man-made illusion. We are the conscious, loving universe. It's that illusion of separation that results in stress and disease and all of the just the extraordinary number of stressful, problematic, if you want to use that term, factors in human existence today and throughout history because we thought we were separate. We are not. 9, humanity is on an evolutionary upward spiral, leading inexorably to a higher reality. The trust frequency, heaven on earth. We're actually evolving. It's not over. In fact, we're in the middle of a great awakening right this very moment. And 10,
The trust frequency is real. It's a real place of unfathomable joy, peace, and abundance that is freely available to anyone, anywhere, anytime.
The above assumptions provide clues to aligning one's life with the abundant, joyful nature of the universe. Trust the loving universe.
Yeah. And we will open it up to questions, and depending on when our beloved host here flings us out.
Beloved now, I like that. So we are in loving universe, so you better get used to me being loved as well.
I just want to wave this
We've
around
got 5 minutes, so
to
anyway.
Say that we are doing a series here. This is the second in the series in the Valley this week, and this has been truly beautiful and a huge privilege, and I thank you so much.
Wednesday night we're speaking at Woody Creek Community Center, Shifting Frequencies, Indigenous Cosmology Meets Quantum Science. So we're really bringing in the indigenous way of knowing, and with some clips from Wallace Blackout from the 90s.
We have a PowerPoint with that presentation. So there, as you can see, we have half a dozen different ways we manifest this material.
So who's got a burning question? Here we are, I knew you had it. Yeah. There is our question.
So you touched on this a little bit when you said internal GPS, because obviously beyond trust, we have to be proactive with different areas of our life, whether it's raising a child or diplomacy somewhere in the world. I mean, you can't just not do anything.
Well, you heard you the know? A, action. In the 7 A's, action.
So anyway, would you say this is, again, sort of developing intuition is really important as to how to be trusting
trusting your inner guidance, yes.
And acting from that.
Acting from
that's
that
That's the
place
kicker. This is not passive. Sorry.
But it's tricky to know intuition, whether
watch the signs.
That's
fear
what we have feelings for. We know we...
Trust your feelings, Luke.
This is training involved here, this practice involved here. It takes practice to know that you can trust your intuition, for example. I'll tell a quick story about, I told it yesterday, I said if there were a minute at the end, your yoga teacher. We pulled in, Connie and I pulled into Manhattan. Everybody knows it's impossible to find parking in Manhattan. Back when I lived in Manhattan, back in the day, we developed a Sufi practice, which miraculously provided parking. You knew where you were going. You didn't do it too soon because another car might get in the spot that had just opened up, because if you did it right here, the car opened us. We pull into downtown Manhattan for this event. Impossible parking. I pull around the corner. I do my little, don't say a word to her, but I do my little inner thing. And I pull around the corner. I park the Trustmobile, which is parked outside there right now, on the street, down in Wall Street. And I'm about to say to Connie, I'll drop you off outside the Trinity Church, and I'll go park the car, and I'll come back and join you. I've got that thought going in my mind, except I've already done the other one. And as I haven't even said that yet, a car pulls out right in front of the church. I look around, the light's red, because I had to get all the way to the other side, get there, look back in, perfect. It works. So,
and we would have been
I have a number of crazy stories around traffic. There is no traffic in the trust frequency.
But your thing about intuition, it's about listening to your higher self. Trust your feelings, Luke, Obi-Wan Kenobi, right? Star Wars. The only way Luke made it through that slit was to let go of the controls and trust himself. Right?
And also thinking positive. It happens to me all the time.
Yeah.
Thinking positive, but
yeah,
also...
It's always happened when I think of that frequency of mind. How I want my day, and even if something comes across me where it's not supposed to, how I plan my day, goes well.
We call that circumstance, you know. I'm proceeding from A to B, and suddenly something comes, boom, and suddenly I'm, circumstance redirects us when necessary.
But
to trust that as well, we have a mind that says, I'm going to get up and I'm going to drive to such and such today. And we have something else that may intervene. They're seemingly uncontrollable outward circumstances, right? Michael, my only answer to that is it takes practice. Connie
loves to tell the story of her amazing young son, Johnny Marlow, who's becoming one of the world's great photographers right now. He's a beautifully trained actor. He sings and plays guitar. And he's a first grade dropout from Aspen somewhere.
Because I put it into practice. When he said, my feelings tell me I don't belong here, and I knew that he came with a gift, that the loving universe would give him everything he needs to become this gift. It's a given for me. I didn't pull him out of school. I let him follow his soul's destiny, okay, because of what I knew. I could do that. That a
he
little
was
boy
a teacher
sitting,
for you.
Huh?
He was a teacher
yeah,
for you.
That's right. But yeah, exactly. My kids took my hand and led me into the unknown. Okay, Mom, you have to walk the talk. But what I want to say is that the intuition thing, listening to your feelings, listening to your intuition, and watching the signs. I don't know if you know, the Native Americans talk about the signs, right?
Synchronicities.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Watch the signs. Who's doing what? Who said what? What, you know, what does the universe want? Because the universe wants more for us than we can fathom. So that's another game changer of this whole thing, which we didn't even go into. And that is that the consciousness field is all set on intent.
The secret.
The secret, all that. Tell the universe what you want. You will get it. Okay? Give it your intent. It's the last thing I want to do is tell the universe what I want. I don't want my little pea brain running the show because the universe wants more from me than I can fathom. I don't want to play this ball game. I want to play in whatever ball game is being played in a higher frequency. So I don't know the rules up there. I don't know anything else. All I've got to do is suit up and show up. Go with a brave, dare not go.
Let's have one at 7:31. Can we have one more
question, please?
Well, I was just going to ask if by circumstance you mean coincidence? What's the difference between coincidence and circumstance?
Well, you remember the definition of circumstance, the seemingly uncontrollable outward events that influence our decisions. In other words, things that we wouldn't have chosen, wouldn't have planned. So coincidence? They're really those things which, as the young lady behind you was saying, you know, I make my plan for the day and something else intervenes. But if you're in the trust frequency, you know that, and the big thing we went into yesterday was rather than being angry at that circumstance, trusting it sufficiently to say thank you, to be grateful, to get a little gratitude in the attitude.
So the words coincidence, depends on how you use it. If you use it with doubt implied, that, oh, if that hadn't happened, then that wouldn't have happened. It was just a coincidence. You've just negated the entire loving universe.
But that's all right. The universe is okay with
but, it. See, we just say, what if? What if it hadn't happened? What if that hadn't happened? That was just a coincidence. We say, yeah.
That. There are no coincidences.
Okay, there you go.
Divine providence.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I don't know if it is divine providence, but this Sunday's sermon, service at the Aspen Chapel, as you'll see tomorrow, those of you who are on the thing, is called Dealing with Circumstances.
Oh, right.
So that's a good story.
And Nicholas is so aligned with this thinking.
So I'd like to say, anyway, to thank you to both of you. I mean, one thing above everything else, you know, these guys are living what they believe. And it's just so obvious in their lives, their presentation, you know, and their whole life is sort of bound into this. They've the book, the presentations, everything they're doing. And I think we're very grateful that they've come and manifested themselves to us here. And thank you very much for doing that, Connie and Andrew.
Thank you for having us.
I'd just like to say that we'd like you to, if you do feel like these are presented free, but there is a bowl over there with contributions. If you'd like to put some folding stuff in there, we'd really appreciate that as well.